Welcome to Breadboarding. This is video 6 in the Breadboard PC series, and in this video we're going to be adding the bus controller, latches and buffers. Our high level plan, we're building out an equivalent of the NanoComp, but using the 8088, so the NanoComp 6809 project was the previous series that this is following on from. And in the previous video, we tested the CPU doing a free run using no operation codes. If you want to see that video, there'll be a link in the top right hand side here. Once we've completed this stage of the project, we'll be then moving on to extend it to do a basic floppy disk PC capable of booting MS-DOS, and after that we'll look at extending that to perhaps add an IDE disk controller and color display and try and run an early version of Windows. We look at our block diagram. So these are the parts we've done already, and when we were looking at the microprocessor in free running using the no operation command to cycle through the address bus and data bus, then we saw it was quite confusing because of the multiplexing of the signals, it was all jumbled up. So by adding the bus controller, so this is an Intel 8288 bus controller and some standard buffers and latches which are going to be used for communicating with the outside world, the data bus and the address bus. So this is a copy of the schematic from the PCXT technical reference guide and also a section of the XI8088 project as well. What this shows is the 8288 down the bottom here and over here, and just indicates where the main source of the information is. So the key thing really is the S0, S1 and S2 signals that come out of the CPU when it's running in maximum mode, feed into down here and actually drive most of these other signals. There are some signals which are identified as not being required and not connected. There's one down here that turned out that was only ever used as part of the dynamic RAM refresh logic, so we don't need that. I'll go into the signals in detail when we go through the datasheet. And what comes out of here, address latch enable, enables these two latches which latch the address data, the lower address data bus AD0 to AD7, to either go through a bidirectional data buffer or to go into this latch which does the lower 8 address lines. Then there's a buffer that we're going to be using for the middle address lines, then another latch to do the upper address lines. Now the difference here is at the moment the A8 to A15 lines are all actually permanent and so don't actually need to be latched. So what I'm going to be doing is using this buffer here to do all 8 signals and just leave the last 4 up here. The main difference really between the original circuit and the new one is that I'm going to be using the 573 series, and the main difference here is that all the inputs are on one side and the outputs on the other. These 3 and 2X series did have the inputs and outputs jumbled up on the same side, which made it a bit more troublesome for plugging into breadboards. The 245 down here is actually the same and has all of the pins on the same side, so we won't be needing that one. So we're going to be using a 573 and a 541 in place of these two chips here. So let's have a look at the schematic that I've extended the existing diagram to cover. So at the top here we had a power supervisor, we had our clock controller, the 8284, and then in the last video we were testing out the microprocessor. And now what we're going to be doing is adding in the bus controller here. You can see here the S0, S1 and S2 lines plug in down to the bus controller here, and all these outputs then largely generated by that. We do also need to feed in the system clock down here as well. And there are a number of pins that she'll go into in a minute as we go through data sheet, which either tied to ground or 5 volts. Then over here we have the bidirectional buffer. We have the lower 8 address lines. We then have the A8 to A15 address lines here. So these are permanently output, don't need to be latched. And then we're only going to be latching the top 4 address lines here. So let's take a look at the data sheet. So all I've done here is identified on here which lines we're using and which ones we're not. But as we go through here, we can see in more detail what's going on. So as I just said, the S0 to S2 is hooked up to the 8088 status input pins. The clock comes from the 8084 clock generator. Address latch enable is an output, and this is what actually tells the address latches when it needs to strobe the current bus signals into the address latches. data enable is used to tell the data bus when it can have control of it. The data transmit receive just basically says, are we reading or writing? And so we will need that. The address enable input is again used by the DMA controller, and for now we just need to tie that to ground. Command enable again is used by the DMA logic, and that will just be tied to 5 volts for the moment. The input output bus mode, this allows it to be either dedicated to IO bus or system bus. Now we want system bus, so we're going to be tying this to ground. And then there are a number of the signals here. Now there are advanced versions and standard versions. The advanced version basically enables the signal a little bit earlier in the bus cycle, so makes it gives a little longer for the signals to actually access the RAM. So the advanced IO write is actually going to the IO write. We're not using the standard IO write. The IO read is just being used as IO read. The advanced memory write again is replacing the other memory write down here, and we're just using that as the memory write signal. I'm not quite sure why the standard terminology used for all the buses is this, and IO read and IO write, but the ones they use here are a little different. And then the memory read command is memr, memory read. Int acknowledge goes to the 8259 interrupt controller. Now we'll be adding those in a later stage, but for the moment we don't need to worry about that. And then this other pin here, again, peripheral data enable, we don't need to worry about that for the moment. I was just going to briefly explain what the difference between these buffers and latches is. So the 573 and the 373, these are transparent latches. And the difference between transparent latches and the 574, which is a D-type edge-triggered flip-flops, they're very, very similar. If we look at the first one here, we can see that we've got all the inputs 1 to 8D, outputs 1 to 8. We have an output enable, but then we have a latch enable signal here. Whereas for the D edge triggered flip flops, we have output enable 1D to 8D, 1Q to 8Q, but then we have a clock. And the difference between the two, if we look at the table at the bottom here, is when latch enable is high, then basically the output reflects what the input is. So if it's high, it goes high. If it's low, it goes low. And then when latch enable goes low, then it will hold whatever the value was active at that point in time. Whereas when we look at the 574, the only time when this actually, we just have to be careful, there's two chips here, the 574 is at the top here, that basically the data will only appear on the output on the rising clock trigger. So when the rising clock goes up, so low from low to high, then it will latch that output. And then from then on, you'll just get the latched output. You tend to want to have these where the timing's much more critical. So for example, in the video controller circuits and things, then we use these types of flip-flops quite a lot. Whereas these 573s, it allows the signal to go out to the rest of the bus as soon as it's available. So this one is more suited to buses, whereas this one here, the 574, is more suited for where timing is more critical, in particular where you have sort of things like video controllers and stuff like that. We then have the 245 bidirectional buffer. That is pretty much the standard sort of part. When direction is high, it's going from A to B. When direction is low, it's going from B to A. And finally, there's also the 541, which is just a buffer. So we have two output enables and the data goes from A to Y. You'll see that these are a lot easier to wire up on breadboards. The equivalent of these, the 241, for example, you'll have the A's and Y's will actually be mixed together on each side. Similarly for the 373 and the 374 also have all the A's and Y's and D's and Q's all mixed up. So it makes it a bit messier when hooking up buses and things. So what we're going to do now is have a look at the existing board, and we'll lay out the new board that we're going to add along this side this to try and work out where best to put the various chips. So this is a circuit as we left it in the previous video, and now what we're going to be doing is adding on another breadboard to the left hand side here, and this is what's going to have the buffers. We also need to add the buffer controller probably down the end here now. I did move this chip down a little to allow for the address lines to make their way up here, but I may have overdone it a little. I think I might need to shift this up by a couple of holes just to give us enough space to put this in comfortably. It will just about fit, but it'd be better to have a couple of holes between the two chips there. So we've got the 245 bidirectional buffer here, and we can see that we've got the address data 0 to address data 7. So we'll probably try and line these up with one of these chips here, probably this one. I'm going to leave a bit of space here just so if we need to add some buffers at a later stage for these output signals, then I can actually put another buffer in there. Then this is going to be the lower address lined. So this is just going to take the same signals here to go there. Then this is the 541 buffer that's going to be taking all of these signals here, which are permanently available. So these are not latched at all, and these are just going to go straight up to here. And then these final four that we've got here, these are going to go up to here and going to be latched. And then we're going to need to send the address latch enable over to the two latches. So it's going to need to go up to here and here. Okay, so what I'm going to do is put the chip labels on the chips. What I will be doing also is taking out these various pull-up resistors for the data lines. I do have a little test board that I can use in place of those. We'll leave some of these pull-ups here still, but the data lines we're going to take out and we'll use something different. Okay, so just going to move all the power rails and the tie to ground and 5 volts up. The resistors that we want to keep we've moved up and take the no operation resistors out for the moment. We just move the chip up 2 strips, shorten the leads coming down from the clock circuit by 2 strips as well so they fit better. We're going to clip the boards together. Then we need to replace the breadboard buddy at the top with a 2-board breadboard buddy. Then I'm just putting in each of the chips and checking that the chip label is the right way around. All of the chips on the left here have got pin 1 facing downwards, which is not the traditional way, but the pin layout works better that way. Okay, so I've made up quite a lot of the wires and cables I'm going to need. So I've got the sort of 3 hole pins to go across these bits, the slightly longer ones needed, 4-way ones need to go across there. I've made up some wires to go across the data bus there, got the decoupling capacitors. I've also made up a number of these DuPont cables. So as I've shown in some of the earlier videos, take the individual ones like this, take those connectors off. So you just take these little connectors off and then replace them either with an 8-way housing or in some cases here, because there was a 7-way, I've got a 4 and a 3. So basically what I've got is an 8-way cable, a 7-way cable, 4-way cable, which I'm going to use for the various address lines to go over here. It's quite likely that I'm going to need to shuffle these around at some point in time. I might have wired up all of them like I'm going to do with this one, but because they're snaking around here a bit, it's probably better just to use these DuPont cables for the moment, and then I'll wire them in perhaps more permanently once I know that this isn't going to change too much. Okay, so I'm going to speed this back up again, and when we come back we should have all of the logic analyzer signals plugged in here and everything wired up and checked off against the schematic. Okay, so we're just going to put in the power rails for each of the chips. Now the one at the top there is going to need a wire coming round to the left hand side because we've got our power distribution clip in there. I'm just going to put the decoupling capacitors in against each of the chips close to the ground rail. Then we're just putting in the data bus going from AD0 to AD7 on the processor over to the bidirectional buffer. Just check what we need to wire up next. So now we're just wiring in the S0 to S2 from the CPU, the clock signal, the direction and the address latch enable. So now we're doing some of the output enable tied to ground for the moment. When we introduce DMA, we're going to need to add these to the board to go from the DMA logic. Just making up some extra 3-way and 4-way leads there. Plugging in the connectors for the address lines. And then put in the logic analyzers on the address lines. With the control signals down the bottom, and then wiring up the data bus as well. Okay, so it's all wired up and the logic analyzer. Now, rather than wiring in resistors, what I've got is this little simple board here. basically there's a pull-up resistor to 5 volts, and if the switch is on, then it ties it to ground. So when this is at the top here at 0, when it's at the bottom it's 1, and so what I've got here is 90 hexadecimal. So I'm just going to wire this in. And we just need to wire in the power rails as well for that board. And what I've also done is I've wired up the connector at the top here to a much better power supply. So hopefully we shouldn't have any power issues with this. So we've got 90 hex. Going into our data bus here, so hopefully if we switch this on we should then be able to see something like what we had last time, only this time hopefully a little bit cleaner. Okay, so I did a little bit of testing. There were one or two things weren't quite what I was expecting, and what the issue was is I'd forgotten to put in a couple of the tying to ground and to 5 volts. So there's this one here, the CEN was also address enable, and the IOB, so those needed to be tied to ground and to 5 volts. And also when I was having a look at the logic analyzer, I was finding that the 90 was appearing on some of the address bus some of the time, and when I had a bit of a think about it and look into it, I'd naively thought that the data enable I didn't need to connect up to the buffer, but in fact the buffer here, if it's enabled all the time, then the 90 no opcode will leak onto the data bus under some circumstances, and was then actually getting into the address bus. So the key thing I was really looking here to do is when we look in the logic analyzer, I'd expect to see the address bus just to show an ascending sequence without any contamination from the data bus from the 90 no operation code. What I've had to do then to wire in the data enable is it needs to be inverted, so I'll put in a small inverter here, then wire this into the output enable on here. So I have updated the schematic. So the bits that I'd forgotten to do was this one here, IOB, address enable, and also this one here. And then what I've also done now is hooked up data enable to this inverter and is now going in here. So other than that, there's nothing else changed in the circuit. So what we can do now, if we go to the logic analyzer, and I'm just going to set this waiting for a trigger. So it's waiting for the reset line to go from high to low, which is when it comes out of reset. And what we'll expect to see here, we've got the A0 to A15 decoded, A16 to A19, which is the top sort of 4 bits, and the data as well. Now what I'll do is I'll turn off the data because that's not going to be too useful at the moment. And when we first come out of reset, what we expect to be able to see is that the 8088 should be looking at the address FFF0, which it appears to be, and the upper 4 bits should also be F. So this is actually looking at address FFFF0. So that's 4 Fs and a 0. And then because we're returning the no operation code, if we look over on the right hand side here, if we turn off these decoded results and just look at the data, you can see the only thing on the data bus is going to be 90, which is no operation. So if we then just look at the bottom 16 address lines, what we can see here, it starts at F0 here, then goes to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, all the way down to F, then back to 0, counts all the way back through again. And what we'll see is if we add back in the top address lines, that in fact it starts off at 0F. Obviously, this is just the initial power on that levels. So we can see that it's F up to here, then we get to FFF and it goes back to 0, and then from then on it will be 0. So the buffers appear to be working okay. I've got the results that I was expecting. It took a little bit of time to work through the data enable, to enable the buffer, but now that I've updated the KiCad diagram, then hopefully all will be good for the rest of the project. So that appears to be working okay, and we can see from this original diagram from the PCXT that the data enable output from the bus controller needed an inverter there to feed into the enable signal here. So we've done that now and updated the KiCad diagram. So that's the bus controller, latches and buffers completed. The next step in the plan is to add the EEPROM and RAM. So that's the electrically erasable programmable read-only memory. And we'll also need to put in an address decoder as well to allow these to be enabled in the appropriate address range. So that's what we'll be doing in the next video. If you don't want to miss out on future videos, please hit subscribe. And if you found the content useful, please hit like. It just helps to make the videos available to a wider number of people. Thanks for watching.